Halloween 2 by Jack Martin. Chapter 6. From this distance, the amber sodium lights of the ER lot were clearly visible. It was an easy walk the rest of the way. In fact, many of the locals left their cars in the shopping center lot, as a matter of course on days when hospital visiting was heavy. Without breaking its lumbering stride, the shape kept walking. 15 minutes later, a red Mustang fishtailed into the staff parking lot. Karen flew out of the car. A thin film of perspiration glossed her face as she reached for her purse and uniform and trotted toward the building. She did not even glance at her wristwatch. Her pink scarf, rendered a sickly green by the sodium lights, streamed behind her like a sea plant as she picked up the pace. She did not take notice of the ominous elongated shadows under the posts or of the landscape flower beds, the arrangements of rocks, and the unhealthy state of the plants there by the back of the building. Nor did she notice the lumbering movement which cast a peculiar ripple along the chrome of the cars at the edge of the lot, coming to a halt at the left rear fender of her own Mustang. The reflection was distorted, but held the anamorphic image of a tall shape in a black coat, arms stiff as it stood next to the red car, staring after her, head tilted curiously to one side. Its mask highlighted and framed perfectly in the circle of the car's outside rearview mirror, like a death's head cameo. The shape waited until the staff door closed. Then it moved on, toward the building. Garrett, the security guard, was watching television. Not the bank of closed-circuit sets which monitored the parking lot and key corridors of the hospital, but the local channel, WWAR, where now another reel of Dr. Dementia's horror movie marathon was airing in grainy black and white. Just now, a montage of clutching hands filled the screen, accompanied by endless blood-curdling screams and a cheap but poundingly effective music score. Garrett settled his enormous gut behind the desk and thumbed through a copy of Mercenary Adventures magazine. The pinup of the month was a full-page close-up of the severed head of an oriental human being mounted on a stick. The sharpened end of the bamboo was pointing out of a vacant eye socket. The caption read, "You don't need an M16 to bring home a trophy from today's peremptory incursions." He wagged his head and chuckled at the picture. On the first of the monitors, something moved at the entrance of the parking lot, then dematerialized off the edge of the screen. But he did not notice this. Above the screams and the music, there came a pounding. Garrett looked up. Hands were pounding the boarded windows of an old farmhouse. Wood splintered under the assault and fingers broke through, clawing and grasping. Garrett returned to the pinup, then flipped ahead to the letters page, which was entitled He-Man to Man. The pounding was more insistent. Garrett swiveled in his chair. A silhouette was pounding on the guard station door. He marked his place in the magazine, cut off the horror movie, and reluctantly got up. He opened the door on darkness. Before it was all the way open, the silhouette pushed inside. "Thanks, Mr. Garrett."
"Hi, Karen," said the guard. "Did you hear?"
"Hear what?"
"Oh, some weirdo's out there cutting kids up. He's..."
"Yeah, on the radio." She hurried to punch in. Garrett hooked his thumbs in his web belt and puffed his chest out.
"It was drugs."
"Was it? I gotta go. I'm late." She folded her uniform over her arm and crossed to the inner door. The plastic bag covering the uniform rippled with dull reflections in the electronic light. Garrett stayed where he was, rocking authoritatively on his heels. Behind him, the monitors continued to scan the inner and outer perimeters of the grounds. On one of the exterior screens, a figure could be seen, passing an unmarked doorway. The figure became a grainy shadow at the edge of camera range, and then melted off the screen.
"Yep," said Garrett. "Teenagers on drugs."
"Seen this flick so many times," Bud was saying. His chin was down and his eyes were having trouble focusing. Jimmy paced the lounge, touching the Coke machine, the countertop, the cups and trays, straightening chairs for something to do.
"Too bad we missed the first picture they had on tonight. Shit, what's the name of it? The Thing. Yeah, that guy from Gunsmoke was in it. James Arness played the monster. This big old hairy thing comes down in a fucking flying saucer. He's all frozen, been in suspended animation since way back when. Then, when they thaw his ass, I saw it, said Jimmy. When I was a kid, I saw the movie.
Right. And then he starts ripping through doors, kicking ass on some dogs. He hangs this one poor son of a bitch upside down and bleeds him.
Yeah. Oh, and there's this phony doctor. He thinks he's the only one who understands the thing. But when he finally gets there, well, the old thing just blows him away like everybody else.
Finally, the soldiers fry him, though, and, hi, Karen!
Karen stuck her head in the doorway.
Hi.
You're late, said Bud.
Yeah,
Karen smiled at Bud and toyed with the ends of her pink scarf.
I gotta get on the ward, she said apologetically.
The hallway behind her was empty, so she stretched it as long as she could.
Hi, Jimmy, she added.
Oh, hi, Karen. Jimmy gave her a half-hearted nod. She adjusted the purse and uniform over her arm and stood expectantly over Bud. The driver's eyes traveled familiarly over her sweater and the taut lines of her designer jeans. He gave her a lazy, slow-eyed grin and crept his fingertips across the table toward her wrist. She stroked one of his fingers. She shifted her weight from foot to foot, still out of breath. The rib pattern of her sweater swelled. In the strained silence, her breast rose and fell. There was the almost imperceptible whisper of her skin moving against the inside of her clothing. She noticed the clock on the wall and withdrew her hand.
See you later, she said.
Right.
Bud watched the designer jeans disappear down the hall. Then he kicked back in his chair and put his hands together behind his head.
Amazing grace, he sang. Come sit on my face.
Look, said Jimmy, why don't you just shut up, all right?
All right, said Bud obligingly. What are you all revved up about?
It could have been Ziggy, you know. Jimmy's words were clipped and fast, half stuttering. It could have been your brother Mark they pulled out of there.
All right, so what do you want me to do? Look, Jimmy, rule number one, never get involved with the patient. Nurses? That's another story. But patients? It's no good. It never works out.
Jimmy lost his patience and went to the door.
Where are you going, college boy?
Jimmy ignored him.
I'm telling you, listen to old Bud.
The door started to close. On the wall outside was a crepe paper decoration. Happy Halloween, it said.
Shit. Bud said after him. You wouldn't have made 15 minutes in NAM, college boy.
You awake? Lori's head rolled on the pillow and her eyes darted to the door, which was ajar a few inches. She had not heard it open. She had been thinking about something. She did not want to think about it. She did not want to think about anything. But the colors had started to form before her eyes and the grainy darkness over her bed, swirling over her in a misty whiteness. And there had been voices, too, heard from far away over a long-distance telephone wire or from another room, a room she was not supposed to enter. And other sounds, a dripping, the color red, the darkest red she had ever seen, and a face turning toward her. She could almost see it. But it was not this face. This was a good face, kind and unbelievably tender, like a brother. Her heart speeded unaccountably, and she raised herself a few inches, suppressing the thought.
Yeah.
Jimmy's face hovered over her. His skin was so soft and blue from the moonlight coming through the window that she wanted to reach up and touch it. But she could hardly move. There was a pain in her shoulder and a constriction in her arm, inside the elbow. An IV bottle swung on its stand as she endeavored to sit up, disturbing a tube that ran from the needle in her arm. She cleared her head.
I've just been thinking.
You shouldn't try to think right now. There, that was proof he understood. He really did.
I know, but I can't help it. I still can't believe it.
Jimmy closed the door. The bluish light through the blinds made a striped pattern over his face, and then the pattern moved. That was because of the leaves outside the window, she realized. They should have handled him more carefully.
Who?
Jimmy's voice was intense, wound up like a spring.
Michael Myers.
Lori could not imagine what he was talking about. Still, something about the name chilled her blood. She did not know why.
Michael Myers? Yeah, he's the guy that was after you.
You mean the Myers house? That little kid who killed his sister?
Yeah.
Jimmy was uneasy talking about it, but it was obvious that he needed to talk to someone, and he was giving her information so that she could understand, begin to understand. She wanted to thank him for that and for the delicate way in which he raised the subject. She was not sure she was ready for the rest of the story yet. Contradictory emotions tugged at her. The need to know and the desire to erase it all from her mind forever. She was not sure which would be easier. Her mind raced. She could not stop it. What he was telling her did not add up. What did it have to do with anything?
But he's in a hospital somewhere.
He escaped last night.
How do you know?
She asked, dubious. His face was so open and uncalculating.
It's all over the radio. TV, too. It's on right now.
Lori felt a wind rush through her chest. It was colder than the night air outside. She forced herself to breathe again.
Why me? She whispered. I mean, why me?
For some reason, she could not keep her breath working right. She lowered back onto the pillow, the blue-white bed. The ceiling swam before her eyes, expanding, contracting.
Oh, God,
she said. The door opened again. Lori squeezed her eyes shut, unable to move.
Time's up, Jimmy, said Mrs. Alves. Let's go.
She opened her eyes and Jimmy was leaving.
Okay, okay, he said, his voice lighter again.
When he looked back at her, his tone remained deceptively casual, but a tension he could not hide gripped his vocal cords so that his words seemed to carry great weight.
I'll be back in just a little while.
No, you won't, said Mrs. Alves. Visiting hours are definitely over. Jimmy signaled from behind the nurse.
I'm warning you, said Mrs. Alves.
With a mocking gesture, Jimmy left. Mrs. Alves examined the dressing on Lori's arm. For the first time, Lori noticed that it was heavily bandaged.
Man, said Mrs. Alves, you can't live with them, you can't live without them.
How's that shoulder feel?
A little better.
Good.
Mrs. Alves softened and smiled maternally. Lori decided she did like the woman.
We've been trying to get a hold of your parents. Dr. Mixter told me they were at the same party he was, but they're not there now and they're not at home. Do you have any idea where else they might be?
Lori twisted the ends of her hair with her good hand. She wanted to pull it over her eyes to keep the pictures from coming again. She wanted to crawl down and draw the sheet over her head, but she couldn't. Instead, she played with her hair.
No, she said, as Mrs. Alves' voice seemed to recede.
I'll just keep trying, then.
Lori repositioned her head on the pillow, following the voice before Mrs. Alves would slip away and leave her here alone. Behind the woman's head, Halloween decorations were visible in the hall. Orange and black lettering, even a real jack-o'-lantern with a candle inside, sending black smoke trails into the air over the desk.
You know what the lettering said?
Mrs. Alves picked up the phone next to the bed. She dialed. She rattled the cradle in frustration.
Oh, this is just...
Lori heard her say. Somewhere down the hall, an elevator door shuttled open and closed. Mrs. Alves said,
Janet!
The dark-haired nurse popped in.
Yes, Mrs. Alves?
Go tell Mr. Garrett we're having trouble with the phones right now.
He's at the other end of the hall. I mean, Janet... said Mrs. Alves sternly.
Yes, Mrs. Alves. Janet hurried away.
The feeling Lori had had all along was beginning to surface now. She could not hold it down. It was the worst feeling she had ever known in her life, and it was getting worse. She did not know what to do about it, except to wait and keep on waiting until she could wake up all the way.
What's wrong with the phones? She asked weakly.
It's nothing for you to worry about. Mrs. Alves smiled, but Lori could see something else in her face, impatience and...
something else. What was it?
Simultaneously, Lori did not want to know.
Just get some rest now. I'll let you know as soon as we get a hold of your parents.
Mrs. Alves smiled her easy smile again and left. The door closed and Lori was alone.
She sat up in bed. The effort made her dizzy. The room, chair, closet, bathroom, nightstand, window, moonlight outside. Something moving. Lori gripped the sheet until her knuckles went white. The movement repeated. It was branches. That's all it was. The branches of an oak tree rustling and scrubbing their details against the pane. They seemed to be scraping the window. She was absolutely sure she was hearing a sound that was not in the closed room a minute ago. It was not a scraping of leaves. It was a throbbing, swelling, quiet, getting louder, closer. She put her hands to her ears and pain shot up her injured arm, but still she heard it, louder and louder. It was the sound of her own heart pulsing in her ears, like a drum beating underwater. Lori shook it off and took up the phone. Mrs. Alves was right, of course. It was dead. Dead, she thought. Dead. Dead. The sound repeated, ticking like a dripping, like an airplane made a low pass over the hospital, breaking the white noise. Lori concentrated and held to it till it was gone, passed over like giant wings beating the air, rattling the Venetian blinds, tick, tick, ticking. Then there was only the sound of her breathing, alone in darkness. But it was not completely dark. She could see shapes begin to shift and move, the chair tilting, the parallel lines of the blinds bowing, the draw cord undulating, like the white sheet over her legs rising and falling, beginning to glow with a light of its own. She shut her eyes tightly. The white light went out, then came on again. It was within her. It had about it the whiteness of eyes, the cold glare of pearlescent flesh. Now she did not know which was worse, the light or the lack of it. The darkness had found a way into the building. It glided down the untended corridors of empty floors. It sank into doors left open, filling the spaces there, and pressing doors closed on shadow. It followed the contours of light that connected halls and offices, leaving them dimmer in its wake. It gravitated toward the night wards where it gained strength. It moved on. At first, there were only a few holiday decorations visible to disturb the sterile symmetry of the hospital. But as the darkness flowed in swiftly and silently, deeper into the inner chambers of the antiseptic fortress, more signposts of the season greeted its coming, as if it was no stranger, but had been expected for a long time. Simple orange and black lettering gave way to animal cutouts and pointed hats, fluttering tails of paper chains, pointed the way to handmade drawings and life-size skeletons beckoning it forth. Pumpkins were everywhere in the east wing, small ones, crooked ones, gigantic leering faces the size of ancient idols, strung along walls and doors, and partitions like road signs. At the end of one corridor, a mad jumble of primitive colors clung to the angles of an otherwise transparent glassed-in area, festooned with masses of crepe bunting and two-dimensional black cats, which arched their backs behind every cart and counter. It was the pediatric ward. The darkness was drawn closer, leaving flickering bulbs and buzzing sockets in its wake. A shadow passed over the first of the cribs. On the other side of the glass at the nurse's station, Karen was catching up on her charting as Mrs. Alves came up beside her. "You were late again tonight," said Mrs. Alves. 15 minutes. That could be the difference between life and death for one of those kids." "You're right. I'm sorry, Mrs. Alves. I just..." Mrs. Alves cut her off. "I don't want to hear any excuses. You're a good nurse, Karen. I'd hate to lose you, but you've got to learn to be on time." Karen lowered her head. "Let's go over this list," said Mrs. Alves. In the infant enclosure, a baby stirred. The sound it made was like a kitten stretching in its sleep. Karen looked up. A tiny, wrinkled pink hand with perfect miniature seashell fingernails raised in the air above one of the cribs. It retracted, and a sucking sound could be heard. "Anything you want me to do?" said Karen. "I'm really sorry." "Car, Mrs. Carr, 9:30 tomorrow morning." They compared their charts. Unseen by either of them, a shape moved on, spreading darkness. Elsewhere in the hospital, "I don't even know how to use this thing," said Janet disgustedly. She was in the guard office. Mr. Garrick kept it so dim that she could hardly see what she was doing. She banged the walkie-talkie against the palm of her hand.
"I'm going to go check the pole," said Garrett. "It'll take 5 minutes."
He hefted the other walkie-talkie and his flashlight and let himself out the back door, leaving Janet with an expression on her face that was somewhere between boredom and outright hostility. As the door sealed behind him, she sighed and shifted her weight onto one foot, holding her walkie-talkie as if it were an overfull specimen beaker. Outside, everything seemed to be in order. Around the corner of the building, the lights of the shops a quarter mile away glimmered like stars through the mist. A few cars were parked in the hospital lot, a 57 Chevy, a Mustang convertible, others that were not so familiar. Garrett activated his walkie-talkie.
"Garrett here," he said, cupping his hand unnecessarily around the mouthpiece.
"Well, who else would it be?" came Janet's crackling voice from inside. "Have you fixed it yet?"
"We're checking it out," said Garrett in a forced monotone. "Tell Karen we've spotted her car in the lot. She better get out there next break and roll that top up. Looks like it's going to be a foggy one."
There was a dumbfounded pause. "Yes, sir," came Janet's disbelieving voice. 10-4, hurry up, will you? Mrs. Alves is waiting."
"Roger," said Garrett. "We copy your 10-4.
Garrett directed his attention to the structure at the back of the hospital. He followed the line of the building until the lot was cut off from his view. He was in an outside loading dock surrounded by cement walls and a ramp. A steel door was rolled down tight and padlocked. He spun his flashlight beam over its corrugations.
"Everything in order here, sir," he mumbled to himself.
There was a sputtering sound. Garrett hooked his beam up. The beam found a telephone pole and hit the ceramic insulators. A solid line of wires fed into the connectors, unbroken. The voltage was crackling, but that was to be expected in damp weather. Nonetheless, Garrett checked it out with eagle eyes, tracing each strand with his flashlight. Not even frayed insulation. He wrinkled his brow, puzzled. He retraced his footsteps to the security entrance. Suddenly, there was a loud crash. He crouched, flashlight at the ready. A few feet away, an industrial trash bin was rocking slightly on its wheels. Garrett tensed. He reached for his walkie-talkie, glanced back at the door at the trash bin. He said into the microphone.
"Yes, is it fixed? Can I tell Mrs.?"
"Never mind. Everything's under control. Stand by."
"But..."
He clicked off and hooked it to his belt, sucked in his chin, raised his flashlight like a gun, and started for the trash bin. His foot struck an empty medical supply carton. He avoided it as if it were a snake and nailed it with the beam. Papers, empty bottles, pages of a catalog flapping in the breeze. He came to the bin. "Dempster Dumpster," read the decal. The lid was closed. He rubbed his fingertips on his jacket, inhaled, and flipped the lid up. More cartons, cardboard dividers, a mangled bedpan, a week's collection of newspapers. On the top newspaper, something wet and red. Garrett probed for it. With a snarl, a cat sprang out of the bin and over Garrett's shoulder. He was knocked off balance. He almost fell into the Dempster Dumpster. His gut jiggled as a wheezing laugh began low in his chest. He aimed his flashlight at the cat as it darted across the open space and disappeared. Impossible, of course. There were no exits from the concrete cul-de-sac. Garrett followed. His footsteps echoed around him. He came to a door marked "Keep Closed." It was open slightly.
"Lock that myself," said Garrett.
The padlock was broken. He swabbed the crack with his beam, then pushed inside. The big steel door rumbled like thunder. The lock swung, clicking behind him. The cone of light swept boxes and crates, electrical parts, tools, clippers, shears, staple guns. They cast jagged shadows on the wall, all exactly where he had left them. At least they appeared to be. There was, however, an empty space at the end of the row of claw hammers.
"Someone getting into my tools again," Garrett grumbled.
He activated the walkie-talkie.
"I'm going to move into the storeroom," he announced. "The lock was out of order."
No response. He walked on down a narrow passage. Along one wall, a series of storage closet doors. The first one he came to had a broken latch. The padlock was nowhere in sight. Garrett screwed up his courage, gripped the doorknob in his meaty fist, clenched his teeth, and pulled. A shape fell on him. A carton of medical supplies, small, elongated plastic packages, scattered over him. He hefted his communicator.
"Somebody's been into the OR-9s," he reported. "Don't look like staff did it this time. The lock was busted."
He groaned to his feet.
"Mr. Garrett?"
"Stand by."
He was holding a supply cabinet. Its lock, too, had been broken, twisted off as if by someone with superhuman strength. He proceeded deeper into the storage hall.
"Better call Brackett's boys for this one," he said. "Do you read? Acknowledge, Janet, damn you, girl. I'm not playing around. Someone's..."
Before he could finish, the next door in line burst open at his back, and tall blackness flowed out. He didn't even have time to get his flashlight up.
"Mr. Garrett? Mr. Garrett?"
The walkie-talkie bounced on the concrete floor and cracked open. Janet's voice continued to filter out weakly, weaker, and was finally cut off as a heavy, very heavy foot came down on it, stepped over Garrett with utter unconcern, and lumbered away. Mr. Garrett, though, had found his missing claw hammer. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 6 of Halloween 2 by Jack Martin. Really enjoyed tonight's chapter. It's getting to my favorite part of the story, of the movie and everything. All the stuff that goes down in the hospital. Such a great setting for a Halloween movie. Like I said, Halloween 2, the original, this Halloween 2, is one of my favorite slasher movies of all time. Probably my favorite Michael Myers movie behind the original. Yeah, part three was cool because I love the whole witch aspect. I thought it would have been a cool movie if they had just called it Season of the Witch and not put Halloween on it. But as far as the Michael Myers Halloween movies go, part two is like almost tied with part one for me. You heard yesterday, you know, my thoughts on the 2018 one. But yeah, anyways, we're at the part that I really have been looking forward to on this story. And looks like Mr. Garrett found his claw hammer right in the head. And it seems like the crap's about to hit the fan here in Haddonfield Memorial. And all right, guys, are y'all enjoying the book so far? Did you enjoy tonight's chapter? Let me know in the comment section below. Hell, if you just want to say hi, I'd love to hear from you guys and discuss these books and movies with you. So I always look forward to you guys commenting on the videos where I can find out what you guys are thinking of the book and discuss my thoughts on it as well. And I hope you guys are enjoying this one. I really do. And I look forward to being back very soon with the next chapter of Halloween 2 by Jack Martin. As always, tonight's upload was brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page. That's Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Iron Elixir, and Allison Sibe. And anybody listening right now that would like to help support this channel and keep it going and growing for years to come, click that Patreon link below, sign up for as low as $2 to $5 per month on the Patreon. You'll get early access to great slasher content. For instance, right now on Patreon, you can get weekly uploads of Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, narrated by me, way before it's going to be on the YouTube channel. In fact, YouTube will not even get the weekly uploads. They'll just get the full unabridged audiobook sometime later on this year. But you can get the early access right there on the Patreon page, and the tiers that start out at $5 a month get you some awesome rewards, including free merch from the merch store, free slasher ebooks sent to your email, and much more. Check it out. I think you might enjoy
the rewards you could get while you're supporting the channel. I really do depend on you guys signing up on the Patreon. I'm not able to monetize the channel here on YouTube because the copyright owners of the books get all of the ad revenue. That's why I go ahead and use regular songs and stuff in the videos, because I'm not going to get the ad revenue anyways. And I really appreciate you guys signing up. Alright guys, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80 Slasher Librarian saying, thanks for listening, have a great night, and I'll see you soon.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Nanny, nanny, I'm ready, my lord. Magnified, sanctified be the holy name. Vilified, crucified in the human frame. A million candles burning for the love that never came. You want it darker? We kill the flame.